Здравствуйте. In the last part, I showed you how to start off with your loader. Now, I'll go over what can be improved, the implementation of a database, and the loading. The first thing to improve is the way we deal with secrets in the API. Hardcoding things like the JWT signing key is bad practice, as if someone were to see it, they could bypass the whole authentication system by signing their own tokens. We can do so by utilizing environment variables, which we will load from an environment file. We can then exclude this file from commits by utilizing the gitignore configuration. The next thing to improve is the structure of the API. Each route should be organized inside of a routes folder in their own group. The authentication routes, like login and registration, for example, will be contained inside of the auth.ts file. One last improvement that can be brought is to change from Node.js to Bun.js. While at the time of recording this video, Bun.js for Windows isn't fully released, it should be by the time you watch it. You can install it by opening a command prompt and pasting this command. Now remove package-log.json and inside of the API folder run bun install. You can now confirm that things work as expected by running the star script bun run start. As the database, we'll be using Postgres. There's no specific reason for using it over other databases, I just prefer it. In order to manage and connect with via the API, we'll be using an ORM called Prisma. An ORM, or object relational mapping, is a tool which basically allows you to perform queries without having to manually write them. It might sound weird, but as you see how it is used, you understand what I mean. For development, you can self-host the database, but for convenience, I advise you use DigitalOcean. No, I am not sponsored by them, but it's a good cloud provider with many solutions. On my panel, I'll head into database, scroll, and select PostgreSQL. I selected the data center closest to me and created the database. In order to set up Prisma with the API, I'll first do bun install Prisma and save it as a dev dependencies. Next, I'll initialize it by running npx prisma init. Now we'll need to modify the env file to change the database URL variable to contain the connection string for our database. I recommend to install the Prisma Visual Studio Code add-on to get syntax highlighting when editing the schema file. Under Prisma, schema.prisma is where we'll configure the tables and columns for our database. I'll first describe a table for the users containing an email, username, and password. Afterwards, I'll create a new folder named lib and add the lib.ts and install Prisma client. Run npx prisma generate and then I'll export the instance of it. Now we'll need to modify the auth routes again to support our new database system. I'll begin by creating a new one for signup. It will check if the user already exists and if not, hash a provided password and insert it into the DB. I'll also modify the sign-in route. It will now check if the user exists in the database and compare the hashed passwords. Now, before running the API, don't forget to push your Prisma schema changes to the database by running bun run prisma db push. Well, we can now get to the last part of the improvements, which involves implementing an injection system which is functional with the API. The first step of doing that will be to modify the database scheme so that it can store information about the available cheat so that later on, the client can fetch this information and display it on the user interface. I made a model called sheets containing the type of cheat, its name, the target process for things like injection, and the path. The path will just be the place where the cheat is stored relative to the API. This system is pretty stupid, but keep in mind that this is something we'll improve on by a lot in the future parts, a bit like the authentication was absolute garbage in the first part, but now it's pretty good and decent. Now, we need to create routes in the API in order to allow the client to fetch required data about the cheats. /cheat/list will return a list of available cheats, and /cheat/id will return the module of the cheat itself based on the provided ID. In the root of the API, I'll make a folder called bin, and in it, add the module of a DLL we'll use as an example cheat for testing. In order to have something to work with, we'll need to fill the database with some information. To do so, download pgadmin, set up the connection, and head into the cheats table. Right-click on it and select scripts, insert script. Now remove the ID as it is auto-generated and fill the required fields. I put internal, Minecraft internal, java.exe, and minecraft.dll. Now just click execute. The client will now fetch a list of cheats if login is successful before switching to the next frame. This next frame will display the information and the user will be able to select and load a cheat from the list. When doing so, the utilities function which fetches the module of the cheats is invoked and necessary information is passed to load cheat. Load cheat will check if the requested cheat is internal or external and load accordingly. For now, we'll only handle internal cheats, but later on, after touching a bit of security, we'll implement other methods. Inject will proceed to parse the module as a DLL and manual map it. It first finds the process ID of the target process based on the target name by iterating over a snapshot of existing processes. Then, it parses the DOS header of the image to check if its magic number is that of a DLL. If it is, the function will proceed with opening a handle to the target process using its ID and parse the NT and optional headers of the module. If you're a bit confused about what DOS, NT, and optional headers are, check out my video that which dives into the PE format by checking the description or clicking the card at the top right corner. Now, using virtual alloc, enough memory is allocated to the target process to make space for the module. If it succeeds, it writes the first 1000 bytes to this allocated memory so that the header of the module are written. Afterwards, the function will iterate over the sections of the module and write each one of them to the allocated memory on the target. Now, because of the way binaries work, the manual mapper will need to go through a process known as resolving, and that directly from the target's memory using a shellcode or a stub. It has to do so because the address we allocated memory to using virtual alloc might not align with the preferred address of the module. So basically, right now a bunch of offsets will point at the wrong places, making the binary unfunctional. The problem now is that the shellcode will require some Windows API functions in order to resolve the module, and since the way we'll make this shellcode is simply by copying instructions from a function of our client, we'll need to pass memory addresses of these required functions dynamically using some sort of structure. In utils.h, I create a manual map data structure and make it contain the required functions pointers as well as a handle which contains the base address of the allocated memory. I fill an instance of it in the injection function by passing the addresses to the functions and write it in a newly allocated memory space. Then, it will allocate memory for the shellcode function and copy its bytes before calling createThread, which will run it while passing the address to the manual map data as an argument. The first thing the shellcode will do is parse the addresses to the base of the map module, the optional header and the entry point. It will then calculate the difference between the base address of the allocated memory and the preferred address of the module, so that it can then perform the relocation. If the resulting offset is zero, then relocation is not required, but otherwise, it checks if the module can even be relocated. If not, it just stops there. Otherwise, go through this, at first glance, pretty confusing process, but bear with me. It first gets the relocation table, which is what tells us what to change for the module to work correctly, since it isn't on its preferred address. The loop will iterate over each block of the relocation table until it reaches the end or an empty block. Another loop will iterate over each entry of the relocation block and patch their offsets by adding the difference to them. Just so you can understand better what the fuck is going on, I have made some illustrations which I'll go over. Each block consists of a virtual address field which contains the offset of the BIBORI page which needs to be updated, and a size of block field which contains the size of the relocation block. Right before the entries of a block is a padding of 1 byte, and each entry is made up of 2 bytes. And are split in 2 fields. The first is the type and is of 4 bits, and the other is the offset where the relocation should be applied and is of 12 bits. Now, by adding the base address of the module with the offset specified at the base of the block and the offsets in the entry, we get the pointer to the location to patch. Next up, the shellcode will iterate over the import table, load the required modules, and resolve the imports using them. And finally, the shellcode will invoke DLL main, or the entry point of the DLL. Here's the final showcase of me logging into the loader and then selecting Minecraft internal and injecting it into Minecraft. As you can see, it works flawlessly. This video is finally coming to a closure. Thanks to all my Patreons for their support, and thank you for sitting through all of it. And if you want to have access to the source code, it is accessible to my tier 2 Patreons, and plus you'll get early access to all my uploads and also an access to some exclusive videos. So thanks, and I'll see you in the next one.